Let's begin with a prayer, shall we? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord God, we give you this time, this class, this give you our whole lives. As we study this whole realm of baptism and confirmation, we ask that you would help us to understand our faith, understand the gifts that you give to us through the sacraments, the power that you wish to reveal into our lives through the sacraments, and help us to be open to those graces. We ask all this as we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So tonight's an important night. We're going to be talking about sacraments that many of you are preparing for. Well, all of you are preparing for at some level, either confirmation or some of you baptism. And so we'll talk about what are these sacraments? Why did God give us the sacraments? What do these things actually do in our lives? And then how do we actually live out those graces? So just a kind of overview of where we're at. We've talked about, you know, the truth and the meaning of life. That's a pretty big subject, pretty big thing, right? The meaning of life is union with God. God created us to share in his own blessed life, both here on earth and in heaven. We've shown how we can prove that there is one infinite, all-powerful God. We've shown how this God actually came to earth in Jesus Christ, who is the Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, the God that Jesus Christ revealed, that God is one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who lives in this communion of love, who calls us into this communion of love through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the one who gives us the fullness of divine revelation, right? We talked about this, and that's transmitted his entire word, everything that God has wished us to know about salvation, about him, about his plan for the world, is given to us, is transmitted through sacred scripture and sacred tradition, and that it's taught and defended by the magisterium, the Pope and the bishops, who are the successors of Peter and the apostles. We talked about how Jesus established the Catholic Church. He set up a kingdom on this earth, a church on this earth, to both guard his teachings, but also to be the instrument of his grace, to be an instrument of his salvation. And so, if we wish to be saved from eternal death, we have to unite ourselves to Christ. We have to unite ourselves. We have to experience his death and his resurrection. We have to experience all the things that he did for us have to hit our lives, have to hit our soul. And so it's a good question to ask is, how's that going to come to us? Jesus died almost 2,000 years ago. How is that going to affect me today? You know, I'm born long, many, many years after that. How is that going to affect me today? And that's through the sacraments. Okay, through the sacraments. What is a sacrament? A sacrament is an outward sign instituted by Christ to give grace. Or another way of saying it, the sacraments instituted by Christ and entrusted to the church are efficacious signs of grace perceptible to the senses. And we can break down that statement. You know, the sacraments are instituted by Jesus Christ. He gave us the sacraments. They're all from him. They were given and entrusted to the church, to the entire Catholic Church. Why? To be efficacious signs of grace. Now, efficacious, what does that mean? It means it's effective. It means it can do stuff, right? A stop sign is a sign. It's not efficacious. It won't make you stop. A barrier with the word stop on it is efficacious. It will make you stop, right? Brick wall is an efficacious sign. It's going to make you stop. So the sacraments aren't just symbolic. They're not just like reminders or merit badges. They actually do stuff. They actually bring us what? They bring us grace. Efficacious signs of grace that are perceptible to the senses. We see this. You know, they're how Christ encounters us in both body and soul. The people 2,000 years ago who walked around, they got to see Christ, they got to hear Christ, they got to give Christ a hug, they got to like touch his garments and be healed. They weren't only the lucky ones. We can actually encounter Jesus Christ now. We can encounter him through his body, the church. We can encounter him in the same way they encountered him, through his power, which he has given to us through the sacraments. So it's a way that he can encounter us today, 2,000 years later, with the same intensity as he encountered the people when he walked the face of the earth. Okay, so how many sacraments are there? Seven sacraments. Okay, seven sacraments to cover every aspect of our lives. So sacraments are baptism, reconciliation or confession, Holy Communion, confirmation, marriage, holy orders, and the anointing of the sick. Now, the three of the sacraments are called sacraments of initiation, which they're the ones that make us fully initiated into the church, make us Catholic. They're baptism, confirmation, and Holy Communion. And then two of the sacraments are called sacraments of healing. They can bring us salvation. They can bring healing to the soul, healing from sin, salvation from sin, and healing even of the soul when we're suffering, when we're about to approach death. And they are the sacraments of reconciliation or confession, as it's often called, and the anointing of the sick. And then there are two sacraments of service, sacraments where people enter into this life, enter into this sacramental realm, not for their own selves, but to give a life of service, to lay down their lives. And that is marriage and holy orders. Right? Marriage has to be a sacrament of service. If it's not a sacrament of selfishness. Why do you want to marry this person? Because they make me happy. You're like, oh, sweetie. Oh, dear. Oh, child. That's not going to... You know, no, you can't enter into marriage like, I promise to be your spouse so long as you make me happy all the days of my life. I don't think those were the vows that people say at Mass. It's about laying down their lives, right? Holy orders, bishops, priests, and deacons who are ordained to serve, given power to serve the people of God. Okay? So, what makes something a sacrament? Let's go over this. One is, it has to be done a certain way. It's called the form of the sacraments. The words that are spoken, the way that it's done. That matters. That is important. Second is the matter, the visible, physical, material reality. Third, it has to be instituted by Christ. We can't just make up our own sacraments, right? I make up my own sacrament of cookies, you know. Nope, sorry. It's not a sacrament. You know, little Timmy can celebrate Mass with the graham crackers, but that ain't Mass. You know, that's not it. And the power of the Holy Spirit given to the church and entrusted to certain people, right? And so... Little 5-year-old Timmy, he can play Mass, but if he even is using bread and wine, even if he says all the right words, nothing's happening because he's a kid. He's not ordained. He doesn't have the power to do that. It's just pretend. Okay. So we'll give a couple examples. So the form of baptism. What is the form of baptism? We have to say the words that Jesus taught us to say. In Matthew 28:19, he said, "Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always until the end of the age." So when we baptize, we say, "I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And what's the matter? What's the visible reality of baptism? Water. I have to use water. Water, which of course points to this whole cleansing, because we use water to cleanse. So Jesus gave us this. He instituted it in Matthew 28:19, talked about it before this. And then, of course, the power of the Holy Spirit is present in the church. Now, with baptism, anyone can baptize in a case of an emergency, but the ordinary person is a bishop, priest, or deacon. We'll talk about that in a minute. Okay, so let's go over baptism. So the scriptural foundation for baptism, let's look at some of the scriptures that Jesus, some of the words of Jesus. We see in John chapter 3, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, and he says, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." It's a pretty strong statement. Later on in Mark 16, verses 15 through 16, he says, "Go into the world, all the world, and preach the gospel to the whole creation. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." So if we believe, we've got to get baptized. There's something that's important there. It's going to do something. Now in Romans chapter 6, it also talks about this whole realm of baptism as well. Are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as being dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. And so we see that baptism, according to St. Paul, actually we experienced Christ's death and resurrection. We die with him. Okay? We also see this played out in Colossians chapter 2. It says, in him you were also circumcised by a circumcision, not administered by hand, but by stripping off the carnal body, with the circumcision of Christ. You were buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. And even when you were dead in transgressions and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, he brought you to life along with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, obliterating the bond against us with its legal claims, which was opposed to us, as he also removed it from our midst, nailing it to the cross. Despoiling the principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, leading them away in triumph by it. And so, you know, in the Old Testament, how did you enter into the covenant? The covenant of Abraham, you entered it through circumcision. Now St. Paul is saying, this is the new circumcision. Not by a cutting of part of your body, but by experiencing Christ's death and resurrection through the sacrament of baptism. And then in 1 Peter 3:20, he makes the analogy, draws the connection between Noah's Ark and baptism. Try to get to that real quick. So it says, for Christ also suffered for sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. And he also went to preach to the spirits in prison, who had been disobedient while God patiently waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. Saved through water, right? It's important. So, you know, God destroyed the earth, destroyed sin by water, but eight were saved through the ark. It says, this prefigures baptism, which now saves you. It is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. Baptism now saves you. It brings salvation to the soul. Again, not just a symbol, not just a symbolic thing. It actually does something. Okay, so what are the effects of baptism? First, the effects of baptism are the forgiveness of sin, both original sin and personal sin. We become a new creation, a child of God. We become temples of the Holy Spirit, a member of the kingdom of God, which is the church, and it receive an indelible mark, a mark on our soul that cannot be undone. You can't undo your baptism. So I want to go through these a little bit because these are so important. So how do we get the forgiveness of original sin? What is the original sin? Who remembers what original sin is? Well, that's the consequence of Adam and Eve eating the apple, brought original sin. But what is the original sin? What is the actual problem that original sin brings? It's the loss of what? Sanctifying grace. It's the loss of sanctifying grace. And so when my sins are forgiven, it's when we talk about sins forgiven, it's important to remember this. It's not just God, okay, I got the list. You need to apologize for this, 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 this. Okay, you apologize for all of it. I guess we're okay now. No, it's actually grace has to live in our soul. It's about a communion with God. It's not about God just not being mad at us anymore. It's about an actual supernatural union with God. And that's through sanctifying grace, this grace that can dwell in our soul that enables us to have union with God, to live with God. And without that grace, we can't get to heaven. With that grace, we will get to heaven. It forgives personal sin, cleanses the soul of both venial and mortal sin, bringing sanctifying grace. We become a new creation. Our soul is changed forever. We're made new. And not just cleaned up, you know, our sins are forgiven, but we're adopted into the sonship of Jesus Christ. This is something that someone can just sit with, you know, day after day after day and meditate on and try to take in that when God wants to save us, it's not just you did some bad stuff, you deserve hell. I'll just kind of let it go. And no, it's not how it all works. Not at all how it works. God joins himself to humanity in Jesus Christ, right? In Jesus Christ is the union between God and man. And so if I want to get to heaven, you know, we've separated ourselves from God. I got to be with Jesus, who is the union between God and man. And so what does baptism do? It makes me part of Jesus. I share in the sonship of Jesus Christ. He adopts me into his identity. We're not just peasants in the kingdom. We share in the very sonship of the Son of God. Right? Today is the memorial of St. Elizabeth of Hungary. And she was a princess in Hungary. and now here she is, a young person. She dies very young. But she knew what her real identity was as a daughter of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. She spent her life serving the poor. She turned one of her castles into a hospital. She would go there twice a day to care for not only the sick, but the most repulsive sick, the people whose illnesses were like no one wanted to attend to them because they were so bad. Here's the princess, you know, taking care of this. She would sell her possessions, sell her clothing, whatever she could do to try to raise money to give to the poor. Eventually, after her husband died when she was in her 20s, she started going door to door begging for the poor. Can you imagine, can you imagine a princess today knocking on your door and saying, do you have any food for the poor? Spend long hours in prayer, but sacrifice yourself. Here's someone who knew that the goal of life wasn't like, I'm a princess now, I can just sit back and relax and servants fan me. Just, I'm a princess of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and I will live as he lived. I will serve as he served. I will lay down my life. We have at our parish princess retreats, for example, where we try to help girls understand what does it mean to actually be baptized. And we have valor retreats for the boys where we try to understand what does it mean to be a son of the King of Kings? What does it mean to be a daughter of the King of Kings? Because a lot of times, you know, people really struggle with their identity, struggle with self-image. How can I feel good about myself? I've done so many bad things, or I don't like myself. I don't like this about myself. I'm not this enough. I'm not smart enough or strong enough or fast enough or skinny enough or tall enough or short enough or whatever it is. You know, there's always something that people don't like about themselves. And say, we are made in the image of God. That's precious in and of itself. But through baptism, even more, we're adopted into the very sonship of Jesus Christ. We're adopted into the sonship of Jesus Christ. That's precious. That's valuable. That's something we could have never, ever possibly earned, no matter what we have done. To share in the sonship of a divine person. For Jesus to actually claim us as part of himself. To give us that new identity, right? How many girls grew up like dreaming about being princesses? You know, and they wear the little outfits, and they like go to Disney World, and they watch all the Disney movies, and they can sing all the songs, right? You know, how many times, if you've got kids, you're like, oh, the Frozen song, you know, Let It Go. How many times have you heard that? You know, if you've got a daughter, you know, a bazillion times. Right? There's this fascination there. Why? Is it because Disney is such great marketers that they've converted everyone in the world to Disney fanatics? No. It's that something God wrote in the soul. For girls, God wrote into the soul a desire to have a radiance all their own. To have a royalty. To be special. To be unique. To be priceless. To be worth something. To be worthy. To have a special place in the kingdom of God. There's something God wrote into a woman's soul that wants to be a princess, wants to have this radiance. And that can be fulfilled through baptism. Now, you are already baptized. You ladies who are already baptized. Did you know that? That you actually are a princess in the kingdom of God. Like, real deal. I'm not speaking nice. No, oh, Father, he's so nice. He's just... You know, he's just being fluffy, and no, it's not a metaphor. This is a reality. You were adopted by God. God is the king, greatest king in existence. No one greater. You were adopted not as some lowly peasant. You were adopted into the very sonship of Jesus Christ, to be a daughter of the king. You know, he can give you a radiance all your own. And you don't need to wear a crown to discover your crown. Crown that was engraved into your soul, an indelible mark that cannot be undone. Do you see that when you look in the mirror? Or do you just see someone who doesn't, well, I don't live up to this standard or this magazine cover or whatever. God isn't in the business of making replicas. He's in the business of making masterpieces. You know, men, who were you baptized? When you were baptized, you were made new. Made a son of the King of Kings. You know, there's a desire in every guy's life, right? Like my nephews, before I got ordained a priest, my whole family went on this big Christmas trip to Disney World because they're like, well, this is the last time we're ever gonna like see Father Matt like before Christmas because I work on Christmas. That's what priests do. And so we went to Disney World, and my nephews, they were young, maybe I don't remember how old, 8 and younger. Because I guess it was 10 years ago now. So, and they couldn't walk past a sword without picking it up and pretending to kill each other. You know, they just couldn't do it. I just watch it happen. It was just so predictable. There's a sword. There's my nephew. There's him killing my other nephew. You know, it's just so predictable. Why? Guys have written into their being by God a desire to feel strong, to feel capable of fighting the battle Do I have the strength? Do I have what it takes to do this? Right? That's why, you know, I'll talk to guys, you know, every time I do marriage prep, you know, if a guy is in love with a woman, I've never met a guy who's truly in love with a woman who hasn't thought about dying for her, who hasn't thought, like, in that moment, like, played it out in his head, like, could I take the bullet? Like, would I stand in front of the guy who's, like, trying to attack her? Like, whatever it is, they think about it. There's something in them that wants to know that they have what it takes. Well, we have through baptism, yes, we have God, the all-powerful one, who has created men to be an image of his strength, to be an image of his might to fight against evil, both in their own hearts and out in the world. And God has created women to be a reflection of his radiance and his beauty, right? His radiance and his beauty. Right? Women are the most beautiful objects God has ever created on this earth, right? It's true. No one comes to me in confession and says, Father, I'm just addicted to watching sunsets. No, they'll say, I'm addicted to, like, looking at images of women, that, you know, in a bad way, right? Or, oh, Father, I'm really struggling. I spend all day Saturday just looking at images of puppies. No, it's not. God has created women beautiful. To reflect his beauty. And through baptism, they become daughters of the King of Kings. And so do you know that? Do you embrace that? Become temples of the Holy Spirit. Who is the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is the infinite, personal love between the Father and the Son, this outpouring between the Father and the Son. And we become temples of that outpouring. The Holy Spirit dwells in our soul. What does this mean? It means that God loves us not just as creatures anymore, right? Not just, he loves us because we're made in his image, and that's valuable and priceless, and even that would be enough to bring great joy. But when he adopts us in Jesus Christ, he actually loves us with the intensity of that he loves the Son with. The Father loves us with the same level of intensity as he loves Jesus, which is called the Holy Spirit. Jesus says this, as the Father has loved me, so I love you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you'll abide in my love. So I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I say these things to you that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. And so we're called to experience that love, the same love that the Father has for Jesus. We become members of the kingdom of God, the church. God has established a real kingdom, both in heaven and on earth. There's the church triumphant in heaven, the church militant here on earth, the church suffering in purgatory. We're a part of this. We become members of this family, right? The saints and the angels become our family members. People will say, oh, why do you guys pray to saints? It's like, at some level, I want to say, why do you talk to your mom? You know, why do you talk to your sister or brother? Like, it's called family, right? That's kind of the snarky response. You know, usually I'm trying to be much more charitable, but it's like, because they're our family members and death does not separate us from them. If they're with God in heaven, you know, God can hear our prayers, of course. God can hear our thoughts, and God can make them hear it as well, right? I mean, we somehow think that, something our cell phones can do, which is connect me to people thousands of miles away, God can't do through prayer? No, of course he can. I can talk to the people in heaven, you know? I can talk to the people in heaven. It makes us members of this family. That's why we'll have statues and pictures. Like, that's our family. When you walk into your house, I probably see pictures of your family in your house. Walk into ours, we're going to see pictures of our family. Right? And this indelible mark. We can reject the grace of baptism. We can lose sanctifying grace. We can even go to hell, tragically. But you can't undo your baptism. Right? And so when Christ calls me up as, I don't want to be Catholic anymore. I want to undo my baptism. I'm like, you ain't that powerful. Sorry. You know, not going to happen. We can reject it, and we can lose our salvation, but you can't undo your baptism. That's why all it takes is a good confession to set things right after someone's been baptized. Okay. So those of you who are preparing for baptism, I want you to spend time with this. This is what's going to happen to your soul. Because we want it. Well, the more we spend time with it, the more we open our minds and our hearts to it, the more we can receive that grace, the more we can be aware of that grace. That grace is going to hit us. When we're baptized, it's going to hit us. But how much of it are we aware of? How much do we allow that to infiltrate every aspect of our lives? That depends on our free will. There's a saying in the church that says, that which is received according to the mode of the receiver. Which means our awareness, our openness to grace can affect how much it changes us. Now, baptism is going to happen, but we can become oblivious. Yeah, I got baptized. Never thought once more about my baptism. It's like putting in all the wiring of the lights and everything and never even going into the room. You know, like, can't benefit from the light if you never go into the room. Okay, so who's the minister of baptism? The ordinary minister of baptism is a bishop, priest, or deacon. Now, in an emergency, anyone can baptize. Because baptism is necessary for salvation, Jesus said, unless you're born of water and spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. In an emergency, anyone can baptize, so long as they do it right and have the right intention. Even a non-believer, actually, as long as they do it right and have the right intention. How? You pour water over a person's head three times, or immerse them three times, saying, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You do that with the intention of baptizing them, the intention of the church, they're baptized. Now, you can't baptize someone against their will, right? Come here. You may say the words, you may pour water over the head, but if they don't want to be baptized, they ain't baptized. You know, God's not violent like that. He's not going to be like, I'm going to give you this grace against your will. So we can't, you can be like on 4th of July, you're like, oh, a big crowd, give me that water hose. I baptize you. No, can't do that. Doesn't work that way. No super soakers. Let's have a water fight. No. Sorry. No baptismal water fights. Okay? What was I going to say else other than that? I don't know. I got distracted. All right. So there are promises that go wrong, along with baptism as well. You'll get asked the questions on the day of your baptism. Verses, do you reject Satan and all his works and all his empty promises? He's the one that tricked Adam and Eve and got them to sin, tempted them to sin, brought original sin into the world, so we need to reject him. Now, and that means more than just, yeah, I reject the demons themselves, like if they were standing in front of me, like come follow me, I wouldn't follow them. But all their works and all their empty promises. Do we reject the empty promise that Adam and Eve bought? The empty promise that, well, if I just do what I want to do, when I want to do it, I'll be happy. That's an empty promise of Satan. You know, all his works, the works of sin. Do I reject sin? It says, I don't want to sin anymore. I want to be faithful to God. That's part of it. That's when we say those things. That's why if someone comes to me and says, well, Father, I want to get baptized, but I'm not willing to do this, or this part of the commandments. I'm like, sorry, you haven't rejected the works of Satan yet. You can't be baptized. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Obviously, you got to believe in God to be baptized. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, ascended into hell, rose from the dead on the third day, and ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty? I do. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? I do. Right? And so, being Catholic, you know, being baptized means it's all in. When you say, I believe in the Holy Spirit, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, means all of it. Right? I think I've mentioned this before. At some level, we're kind of an all-or-nothing religion. The minute you start taking pieces of Catholicism out, you destroy Catholicism. It's not Catholicism anymore. You say, well, I want to believe this, but not this. That's not Catholicism. That can't stand. Because we believe that Jesus established the church's teachings are from God, therefore they're perfect. Therefore they're perfect. And so when someone wants to be Catholic, they have to believe everything the church teaches. All of it. Okay? all right, went through that. Okay, so I kind of hinted at this. Is baptism necessary for salvation? Yes, this is what the Catechism says. The Lord himself affirms that baptism is necessary for salvation. He also commands his disciples to proclaim the gospel to all nations and to baptize them. Baptism is necessary for salvation for those to whom the gospel has been proclaimed and who have had the possibility of asking for the sacrament. That's an important line. It's necessary for salvation for those to whom the gospel has been proclaimed and those who had the possibility of asking for the sacrament. Right, and so in the church we hold these two scriptures, you know, unless you're born of water and spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And God wills that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, which is in the letter to Timothy. And so it has to be possible for everyone on earth to get to heaven. Otherwise, God would have created people to condemn them to hell. No, anyone on earth can get to heaven. They have the possibility. But those who know about baptism, have had the gospel proclaimed to them, and reject baptism, they're rejecting the means of their salvation. And so they're rejecting salvation. Those who have had no possibility of asking for the sacrament, no possibility of knowing about it. So you think of people 35 AD, North America. They have no possibility of knowing about Jesus, no possibility of hearing about the gospel. Can they experience, they have no possibility of being baptized. Is it possible for them to get to heaven? Yes. We'll talk about that. How? Okay, so the church says the church does not know of any means other than baptism that assures entry into eternal beatitude. This is why she takes care not to neglect the mission she has received from the Lord, to see that all who can be baptized are reborn of water and the Spirit. God has bound salvation to the sacrament of baptism, but he himself is not bound by his sacraments. So, this is what God has set up, and we can know that, we can be sure that when we're baptized, we're experiencing these graces. I forgot to mention some of the other effects of baptism is the infused theological virtues of faith, hope, and charity. We're given these graces to believe, to hope, and to love, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, wisdom, knowledge, counsel, piety, fortitude, understanding, and fear of the Lord. These graces to live out our faith. So God has bound baptism. It does stuff. But he obviously is not, he can do whatever he wants. He's not bound by the sacrament saying, well, you didn't get baptized, therefore there's no way you can get to heaven. Well, there has to be a way, otherwise God would have created people that couldn't get to heaven. Okay, so let's look at this. So we talked about Mark 16, who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. So faith leads to repentance. Repentance leads to baptism, and then baptism leads to a life of grace. He's talked about John, 1 Peter, baptism now saves you. Unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. So what about infant baptism? You say, well, Father, you know, baptism is such a big deal. Maybe I should let my kids decide for themselves. Maybe I'll wait till they're older, not baptize them as babies. You know, let them decide if they want to do this or not. I'd say, well, you don't do that with anything anything else that's important. Food. I'll wait till they're older, see what they want to eat before I feed them. You'd recognize they're going to die if they don't eat, right? Do parents let their kids decide whether they want to go to school or not? I don't want to go to school today. Okay, stay home. No, they don't. They're like, you're going to school. You need to learn stuff. Anything that's important, parents who have their children, they have a responsibility to provide for their children, to care for them, to keep them alive. Well, parents also need to recognize their kids need the grace of the sacrament. My kid has original sin. That child needs grace. That child needs sanctifying grace. We don't deprive them of divine adoption. We don't deprive them of the covenant. Just like in the Old Testament, they didn't wait until you were 18 to decide for yourself. Hey, do you want to get circumcised? No, they said, day eight, you're getting circumcised. You're a baby, 8 years old. Because they wanted the child to be a part of the covenant, to grow up in the covenant rather than to grow up without the covenant or outside of the covenant. We want kids to grow up with the grace of the sacrament because we think it's going to actually help them rather than saying, we're going to make you grow up without grace, without sanctifying grace. We make you grow up without salvation, without the indwelling of the Holy Trinity. No, that's going to affect them. They're growing up living without what they need to get to heaven. I got this chalice, but it's just going to sit on a shelf for 8 years. Not going to do anything with it. Not going to fill it up. You're like, why did you do that? We're made for grace. And so when a child comes into existence, child's born, bam, kid needs the grace. That's why I even tell, when the child comes into existence at conception, that parent should be praying with that kid, should be praying over that kid, trying to, call down the Holy Spirit, trying to bring God's love to that child because that child has a soul, and that soul has needs. Okay. And so, but they say, well, but what about faith, Father? The faith. Well, it's the faith of the parents, just like it was in the Old Testament. The faith of the parents is applied to the kid. And so we see this in Mark chapter 10, where Jesus says, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. And then we see this in other places in the New Testament, in Colossians and the Acts of the Apostles, where when people converted to Christianity, when they became Catholic, and they were baptized, it says their whole household was baptized. So dad heard the gospel and was like, everybody's getting baptized, which presumably is the kids too. And we would also look at, look to the realm of course, the Old Testament, like I said. So, you could enter into the old covenant at day eight, but somehow you're not going to be able to enter into the new covenant, which is better and brings more grace and brings salvation until many years later, that doesn't make sense. Okay. All right. So, what about people who aren't baptized, Father? I'm not baptized yet. I'm a catechumen, some of you are not catechumens yet because you haven't gone through that rite yet. For catechumens who die before their baptism, their explicit desire to receive it, together with repentance for their sins and charity, assures them the salvation that they were not able to receive through the sacrament. So you guys in the class, you're like, oh, Father, baptism is necessary for salvation. I'm not baptized. Let's go upstairs right now. Let's do this. Okay, you need to learn about the sacraments. You need to learn about the faith. We've got to teach you some stuff. So right now you should repent of your sins and say, Lord, I want to follow you. I want to turn away from all my sins. I want to love you with all my heart, and I want to be baptized. Well, then the Lord's going to work through that. Same people ask me, like, oh, Father, if someone, you know, commits a mortal sin and they die on the way to going to going to the church for confession, are they going to go to hell? Like, God sees that their intention was to get to confession. They were on the way. You know, again, God has bound grace to the sacrament, but he is not bound by the sacrament. He can see, like, they're on their way, you know. But if we're saying, oh, well, you know, I'll go to confession on my deathbed, that's called the sin of presumption and is a sin. Right? I'll just go to confession later. God knows I eventually want to die. I want to be forgiven right before I die. Yeah, no, God knows you want to do all your sinning right now and shove him off to the side and not care about it until you're about to go to hell. You know, like, no, that's messed up. And God sees the heart. He's be like, no, you weren't, what's the saying? The saying is, those who say they'll repent at the 11th hour die at quarter till. So don't wait. Don't put it off. Now, what about people who aren't in RCIA? What about these people 35 AD in North America? Since Christ died for all, and since all men are in fact called to the one and same destiny, which is divine, we must hold that the Holy Spirit offers to all the possibility of being made partakers in a way known to God of the Paschal mystery. And this is a key line. Every man who is ignorant of the gospel of Christ and of his church, but seeks the truth and does the will of God in accordance with his understanding of it, can be saved. It may be supposed that such persons would have desired baptism explicitly if they had known of its necessity. So, person in 35 AD, North America, no possibility of hearing about Jesus. Well, then God's going to look at their soul. Were they following the truths that they did know? Because there is a law written into our very nature. There's a moral law written to our nature. And we are able to know about God just from, looking around. So that's what Romans chapter 1 says. We should know God from the things that are. We can look around and say, who made all this stuff? Where did this all come from? You know? And so if someone is following their understanding of the truth, is trying, then it would be, if they were given more truth, they were going to grasp onto it, right? They get to judgment day, they'd be like, oh, finally, this is all that I was looking for. But if someone who doesn't know about Christ, is ignorant of Christ, and is not following the will of God and their understanding of it at that level, then they're rejecting the truths that they know, which means they're rejecting the God of all truth. Of course, our response needs to be, we need to share the gospel. Because we don't want to leave it to chance. We don't want to leave it to ignorance. Right? Oh, well, you didn't know any better, so, we'll just kind of throw the dice, hope you get to heaven. We want people to know. Ignorance in this case is not bliss. Ignorance in this case is very dangerous. Because they're ignorant of the gospel in Christ. They're ignorant of his salvation. And if we love them, we say, we want you to have this grace. We want you to know the power of being a child of God. We want you to know the power of having sanctifying grace, having God dwell in your soul. That brings real joy. It's what we're made for. It's what we desperately need. What about babies, Father, that die before they're able to be baptized? Babies that die in the womb or die without baptism. So the catechism says this, as regards to children who have died without baptism, the church can only entrust them to the mercy of God, as she does in her funeral rites for them. Indeed, the great mercy of God, who desires that all men should be saved, and Jesus' tenderness towards children, which caused him to say, let the children come to me and do not hinder them, allows us to hope that there is a way for salvation, a way of salvation for children who have died without baptism. All the more urgent is the church's call not to prevent little children coming to Christ through the gift of holy baptism. Right, and so someone who's a child who's dying in the womb doesn't have any possibility of seeking the truth or doing the will of God in accordance with their understanding of it. But they have original sin. And I said, original sin is enough to keep a person out of heaven. But if God is going to be good, he has to at least make it possible for this new being, this new person, this new human person to get to heaven. How's he going to do that? How's he going to offer salvation to a child? We'd say, well, we trust that he's going to find a way. We're not there. We can't We can't see that moment. When we get to heaven, we'll be able to see how he does that. But we trust that it has to be possible for every person to get to heaven. It may not be easy, but it has to be possible. Okay. All right. So, Catholic way of thinking. What is needed for salvation? What is needed for salvation and a life of grace? We need faith. We need sanctifying grace. We need baptism. We need the Eucharist. We'll talk about that next week. We need the church. We need the Catholic Church. We have to stay out of mortal sin and get to confession if we do commit a mortal sin. We have to persevere in charity. So I've mentioned this before. We are not a minimalist religion. We don't look at it like, what's the absolute minimum I need in order to get to heaven? That's not a loving way to look at our relationship with God. It's Christ changes our... We turn to Him through faith, which of course is a grace in of itself. God helps us believe. We need to experience sanctifying grace through baptism. And then that leads us to communion with Christ in the Eucharist, all within His church. And we have to persevere in that, right? Because most times we're not dying right after our baptism. We have to persevere in that grace. Persevere in charity and staying out of mortal sin. So now someone who's, trying to attack us, I say, well, isn't that like earning your salvation? No, of course not. It's about grace. And it's about responding to grace. Otherwise, we'd say, well, believing then is earning your salvation. You believed, and no, it doesn't. No, all these things are grace. God wishes to give us life, not just get us on a list. We're not minimalists. It's a whole life. Okay. So, how do we speak about salvation? One, we need salvation. The scriptures say all have sinned and are deprived of the glory of God. Again, like an empty chalice. We need salvation. Christ Jesus is the only Savior of the world. We have to believe in Him, and we have to believe in a life-giving relationship with Him. We have to experience the power of His death and resurrection. It's not enough to just intellectually believe. The devil intellectually believes, but the devil doesn't have a life-giving relationship with God. The devil doesn't experience the power of Christ's death and resurrection to change our souls. Jesus gives us life through His body, the church. We have to stay on the vine. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who remains in me will bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. And so how do we get on the vine? Through baptism. How do we stay on the vine? Through Eucharist and reconciliation, and persevering and sanctifying grace. So someone comes to your door, they knock on the door, like, if you were to die right now, would you go to heaven? Well, we can be honest in that moment if we want and examine our souls. Well, I'm not aware, I've been baptized. I'm not aware of any mortal sins. I hope so, sure. I'm great, And for them, they might say, well, aren't you absolutely assured? Well, not until the moment I die. It's not this, because it's not a list, right? For them, it's just, you got on the list, right? Jesus covered you with His righteousness. And so it's just imputed to you. It's like, no, it's a relationship. It's a life-giving relationship. So I would say, have you been saved? I'd say, I have been saved. I experienced salvation at baptism. I experience salvation every time I go to confession. And I hope to be saved in the last day, my last moments, with that grace of final perseverance. Right? So I have been saved. I frequently experience salvation. And I hope to be saved. That's part of a relationship. So let's talk about confirmation. Sacrament of confirmation, which I think everybody here is preparing for, unless you're auditing the class, which is fine. The confirmation, we see this play out in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, in Pentecost. And I want to read this to you guys. Because confirmation, in a way, is basically participating in the grace of Pentecost, the grace that the apostles experienced. Okay. When the time for Pentecost was fulfilled, now Pentecost at that time was a Jewish feast that people had gathered for. When the time of Pentecost was fulfilled, they were all in one place together. And suddenly there came from the sky a noise like a strong driving wind, and it filled the entire house in which they were. Then there appeared to them tongues as of fire, which parted and came to rest on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues, as the Spirit enabled them to proclaim. And so then they go out and proclaim the gospel, and people from all different parts of the area who spoke different languages were all hearing them in the same language. And Peter got up and gave a great Pentecost speech, and 5,000 people were converted and baptized. What's happening is Jesus promised that after he ascended into heaven, he would send the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit to be with them, to guard them in all truth, to remain with them always. And so he does at Pentecost. They experience this outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And so confirmation is an experience of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Another scripture passage is Acts chapter 8, where we see a distinction between baptism and this other thing, which we call confirmation. It says, "Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For it had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit." So we say baptism makes us temples of the Holy Spirit, right? So we receive the Holy Spirit at baptism. But yet there's a different type of receiving of the Holy Spirit that the apostles have to do. Not the disciples who could baptize, but the apostles, the bishops of the church. And so we see this distinction being played out. They've been baptized, but somehow they hadn't received the fullness of the Holy Spirit. So the apostles come in. Boom. Well, that's the sacrament of confirmation. So what does baptism do? We receive the grace of Pentecost into our souls. Another way of saying it is receiving a greater capacity to receive grace and to live by the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So you might look at it this way, you know, baptism is like, putting the wiring in this room for the lights to go on. Confirmation is like putting in some more wiring so that they can really light up. You know, they're like boom, high beams. It gives us a greater capacity for grace. So confirmation is the perfection of baptismal grace, strengthening of those graces. So now the gifts of the Holy Spirit, as I mentioned, we see these in the scriptures. The gifts are wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude, knowledge, piety, and fear of the Lord. One way to understand the gifts of the Holy Spirit is every aspect of our humanity needs grace. And so my mind, my intellect, needs grace, both in understanding the things of God, understanding practical things. And these are the gifts of wisdom, knowledge, understanding, and counsel, how they affect my practical side of my intellect, my intelligence, and the speculative, my ability to understand spiritual things. My emotions, my passions, which can go all crazy, need grace as well. And that's called the gift of the fear of the Lord, where it's like, don't sin, you know? I don't want to offend God. There's part of my heart that needs to persevere in the difficult times. That's the gift of fortitude. Part of my heart that needs to love, and that's the gift of piety. And so it's how grace affects every aspect of our humanity. So what are the graces, what are the effects of confirmation? Well, like I said, it's basically taking all the graces of baptism and strengthening them. So we want a definition of what does confirmation do? It perfects baptismal grace. Or confirmation is being strengthened by the Holy Spirit to live out our faith. It's another way of saying it. So we talk about it. Confirmation perfects baptismal grace. It gives us the Holy Spirit, roots us more deeply in the divine filiation, in our divine adoption as children of God, roots us more deeply in our identity as children of God, incorporates us more firmly into Christ, strengthens our bond with the church, associates us more closely with her mission, and helps us to bear witness to the Christian faith in words accompanied by deeds. Another analogy I like to use, maybe kind of a more knightly realm type of thing. I think of, so like baptism makes you a child of the king. Confirmation is putting on the armor to go out into the battle. Right? And back in the day, the old rite, back before the 50s or before the 60s, when you got confirmed, the bishop came, he would slap you on the face. You know, not a hard slap. It was, you know, a little tap. But it was a way of saying, like, you are a soldier for Christ now. This is a real battle. Wake up, right? Because there is a real battle. And we are strengthened by the Holy Spirit to embrace the mission of the church. So again, baptism might make us children of God, gives us this new identity. Confirmation is going to strengthen us to live that out in this world that needs Christ, this battle that we're in. Okay, who can be confirmed? Any baptized Catholic not yet confirmed? You got to be baptized in order to be confirmed, and you got to be Catholic. We do not accept the confirmations of other Protestant religions. With like Lutherans or Methodists might have some form of confirmation. They don't believe the same thing as we do about confirmation, and we wouldn't say that that's a real confirmation because who can confirm? Only a bishop or a priest with permission. And Protestants don't have that. They don't have bishops and priests, not valid ones, not real ones at least. How is the sacrament celebrated? It's taking a chrism, sacred chrism, which is this oil that's been blessed by the bishop, anointing the forehead of the baptized. So you put your hand on the person's head and say the priest or bishop says, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Makes a sign of the cross on your forehead. Be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so this is the laying on of hands. Bishop's putting his hand on my forehead. Be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. If that doesn't happen, you ain't confirmed. Right? If it does happen, bam! Grace is there. Now, it's interesting. Each year when people are confirmed, sometimes they experience different things. Because grace is something supernatural. It's something spiritual. It's not something automatically that's going to make us have feelings or emotions or physical sensations, right? So, sometimes people think, when I get confirmed, it's going to be like getting hit with a lightning bolt, right? I'm going to feel like, zap, oh, Well, it's a spiritual thing. It's a supernatural thing. It's coming to the soul. Now, sometimes God can make us feel the effects of grace on a physical level, right? There are many times where I'm praying over someone for the sacrament of confirmation, and I'm experiencing something. Something's happening. I don't know how to describe it. But I'm like, the best thing I can think of is like wind that's just like coming down. The Holy Spirit's just like whoosh, and like that's a real thing. You might experience some of the effects of that in a physical way, maybe. Maybe you won't. Now, when I was ordained a priest, I felt it. It was like when the bishop called down the Holy Spirit to like the moment that you actually get made a priest, I was like, whoosh, all the way through my body. I was like, that just happened. Like, that was real, but other guys may not have experienced the feelings of it, but they're not any less ordained. They're ordained. It's just what God wants to do. But we can definitely experience the effects of it afterwards, hopefully in our lives, in our soul, in our relationship with God, and our ability to pray. I had one of my friends, Father Peter, he got confirmed when he was in eighth grade, and he said, my grades went up after I got confirmed. I was like, gift of the Holy Spirit. If you're open to the grace. So can it happen? Sure. Okay. And again, in confirmation, you renew your baptismal promises, the ones we already went through. Do you reject Satan and all his works and all his empty promises? Do you believe in God the Father Almighty? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body? Do we believe these things? Because again, the connection between confirmation and baptism. At confirmation, we also take on a saint name, a saint whose life inspires us, and that becomes part of our name. Maybe not on a state of Colorado level, but in a real way, it's part of our name. So I wasn't really with it when I was getting confirmed. I remember the classes. I don't remember really learning much, but I wasn't really paying attention. Maybe the teacher was great and I was just out of it. But I remember like they said, well, who's your confirmation saint? And I was like, I'd never even thought about it before that moment. And I said, is Matthew a saint? Yes, that's my saint. I was like, that was the extent of my thought process. So I am Matthew Searle, or Father Matthew Searle, Matthew Hartley. It's part of my name. But I would encourage you to spend a little more time thinking about the saint that you're going to get confirmed under. Because when I confirm you, I'm not going to say, Leandra, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to say, what was your saint? Gemma, that's right. Gemma, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? I've already confirmed her. So to pray about that, you can go to prayer and you can say, God, who do you want to be my saint? Will you find a way to tell me? Will you find a way to let me know? And then maybe start doing some research, right? Can't just sit on the couch and do nothing. All right, God, you're going to figure that out. I'm going to watch the game. You know, you got to actually do stuff. You know, we have to actually do some research, spend some time. And then maybe when you're reading different lives of the saints, someone just jumps out at you. You're like, oh. And then you just talk to that saint. Hey, do you want to be my saint? Right? Now, sometimes very providential, miraculous things can happen. Where, you know, you'll have all sorts of stories, like, I might be mixing up stories, but I'll just, this is similar to something I've heard, I don't remember. It all gets blurry in my head after so many years. Where someone was praying about this, and then they thought that this saint would be a good saint, and all of a sudden, like, someone gave them a medal of that saint, like, within days of them thinking about all this. You know, or stuff like that can happen. Okay? And so to pray about that, to pray about which saint is inspiring you, who do you want to imitate, because those saints have a real relationship with us. They can have a real relationship with us. You know, I think of all the saints that are involved in my own life. You know, like St. John Vianney, the patron saint of priests. I know, I've experienced him praying for me, like being present to me. I was like, whoa, he actually really cares. Or St. Padre Pio, I've experienced that many times, where I've experienced him showing up and like showing that it's like, hey, I actually see you, I actually care about you, I'm actually praying for you. My one of my first experiences of this, how are we doing on time? Okay. One of my first experiences of this was when I was about to get ordained a deacon, and somewhere around there. I'm getting old, things get confused in my head. I have little like gray hairs. It's happening, you know. So I think it was after my ordination to the diaconate, which I was ordained the day before Padre Pio's feast day. And so like this lady for Advent was like going around with like these saint quotes, like this bowl. She's like, pick a saint, and that saint will pray for you. And I'm like, oh, come on. Yeah, I was kind of grouchy even then. So, you know, I've always been a bit curmudgeon-y. And so, but I picked a saint, and I picked up a quote, and it was St. Padre Pio. And it was, I don't remember the quote right now, but it was a great one. And I'll think of it in a minute. But, you know, I asked in intercession, and for the time I was a deacon to the time I was ordained a priest. And so, what do? I after I get ordained, I go to my first parish, go to my office. What do I see right above my desk? Huge picture of St. Padre Pio right above my desk. And I was like, all right, you know. Or St. Gemma Galgani is another one of my favorite saints. And I really felt like she was interceding for my life. And so I finally got to go to Lucca, where she's from. And I just booked my tickets on the, you know, I just booked a hotel on hotels.com, like the cheapest one I could find, because I was like, I'm by myself, what do I care, you know. And so when I got there, I didn't know where anything was, and I was in Rome, so I just took a train to Lucca, and it's like, there was like multiple Lucca blah, blah, blahs, and I'm like, I don't know, I hope this is all right. So I just got off the train, and it turned out I was in the city of Lucca, and I just walked over to the nearest hotel I could find, and I said, do you have a map of Lucca? And they did, and they said, well, you know, do you know where the Basilica of St. Gemma is? Now, Lucca's a very big town. It's surrounded by a wall, but I would say Lucca is close to the size of Greeley, which is fairly big if you're walking, you know. And he said, I said, well, do you know where the Basilica is? And he's like, yeah, it's right there, you know. And it was about a mile away, and I was like, oh, that's pretty sweet. Now, I had an idea that, like, this is a big map. I was like, do you know where my hotel is? I'm thinking, oh, man. Yeah, it's right there. It was right across the street from the Basilica. It was the closest hotel to the church. I mean, it was, and I was like, that's St. Gemma right there, man. It's like, I want you close to me. And I was there on one of her feast days. I'd gone and visited to the different churches, like where she was baptized, where she made her first communion, where she got confirmed and stuff. But I couldn't find her house where she, like, you know, died and had, you know, had the stigmata and everything. And so finally I went to talk to the sisters there, and I said, sister, you know, I can't find her house. You know, like, oh, you come back tomorrow. You come back Sunday. We will take you there. I was like, oh, great. And so on Sunday I go, and they just hand me the keys to her house and say, we're going to drop you off. Will you chaperone these people? Like, and they just left me at her house by myself chaperoning other people. And I'm like walking around St. Gemma's house thinking, you know, I could totally like ransack this place. I'd burn in hell for that. But, you know, I just felt the trust, you know, and the love of like, here's this, you know, group of nuns are just trusting me with all these things, you know, and had the keys to St. Gemma's house. How cool is that? So the saints can have real, they can do stuff in our lives. They can have real involvement in our lives. Okay. So any questions? No questions in the box either? No? Yes. What about people who convert on their deathbed? Well, I mean, if it's sincere, I'd say thanks be to God that they repented on their deathbed. You think of the good thief on the cross who was crucified for stuff he had done. I mean, he admitted he was that. But so they can, you know, if they're baptized on their deathbed, the graces are there, straight shot to heaven. Because baptism both does away with their own personal sins and does away with all what we call the temporary punishments due to sin, like all purgatory time as well. But now if someone is, but let's say someone is already baptized, they've rejected the church, they lived 30 years without going to Mass, and on their deathbed, they'll call the priest. They're going to have a long, you know, hopefully, if they're open to the grace, they actually repent, they can have their sins forgiven by going to confession, be anointed, but they're going to have a long time in purgatory because those sins have consequences. No one makes a fool out of God. And that 30 years of sin has affected their soul. And so they can still get to heaven, but they're going to have a lot of purgatory time. And what I would say is also, you know, people shouldn't play the game because I go to the hospital a lot to anoint people who are dying. And most of the time, they're unconscious. And guess what? I don't know if you can repent while you're unconscious. I don't know. You know, so the question is, for me, the question, I go and anoint someone, oh yeah, they haven't been to church in 20, 30 years. They're unconscious. I can't talk to them. I can't hear their confession. I'm like, I mean, at some level, I'm thinking, hope this person is open to the grace. Because if they're not, it's not going to do anything. You know, if it is, great. So that's why also we would say, you know, this concept of, oh, I just want to die in my sleep, or oh, just morphine me out of consciousness. I don't want to be awake. No, like for me, I want to be awake when I die. And I think that sounds weird to people. Like you can be awake when you die. You're like, yeah, that's okay. That's normal. Because we need to prepare for death. We're not doing anyone any favors by morphing them, knocking them out with drugs. Say we just want to make them comfortable. They need to prepare for death. Yeah, we don't want people to suffer in great agony. But we also would say it's not good to just have them unconscious for 2 or 3 days when they could be preparing to meet the Lord for 2 or 3 days. So there has to be a balance there. Okay, we can alleviate some of the pain, but there's a good of preparing. Okay. Okay. Other questions? Uh-huh. Catechumen, you mean?
Why is it later than how can somebody come up later and say that was true?
I don't know what you're talking about. I mean, if the church has defined it, no one can undermine it. So anyone who is saying somehow that, and you know, so what his question was the church defined that a catechumen who is pursuing baptism, they have repentance and they're pursuing it, but they die before their baptism, God would see the heart and, you know, they'd have that grace there before they're able to be baptized. Well, if someone comes along later and says that, they're just wrong. That's just not Catholic, right? So a priest or a bishop even could say stuff that's wrong. They have free will. Pope can't. Pope cannot define church doctrine contrary to the faith. Now, he might, you know, he could mess up in passing, but when he's speaking as a successor to Peter, God won't let him be wrong. So what I'd just say is, well, that bishop's a heretic, or that bishop is wrong, or that priest is a heretic and is wrong, and needs to get in line with the teachings of the church. So, and there have been some bishops who have tried to go that route, but, you know, they're just wrong. So that's the important thing about being Catholic is we are following the teachings of Christ through his church, not any individual. And so when someone says, you know, when Father gets up there and says something, you're like, Father, can you prove that's in the teaching of the church? For me, I'll be like, absolutely, of course I can. And I'm going to say something that's the contrary of the teaching of the church. And if I'm ignorant, someone's like, well, Father, you know, the church teaches this. I'll be like, all right, I believe that then, you know. We always have to be with the church, not with any one individual. Yeah, Adam. So concupiscence is the inclination to sin, our desires to sin. And so when we die, of course, if we don't die perfect as a saint, we're going to go to purgatory. What happens in purgatory? The fire of God's love purifies the soul from any attachment to sin. And so that desire for sin is going to get burned away. And then in heaven, the beatific vision, we experience the grace to be able to see God as he is in his essence, to be able to have communion with God. And that captivates the will in such a way that we would not desire anything else. And so someone who is in heaven cannot lose heaven because they have an infinite good that they cannot turn away from, nor would they ever want to. And so there's not going to be this desire then to do bad things because you have the fulfillment of all your desires by having God. Any other questions? Okay, I want to talk to you about a little couple of Catholic cool stuff things that I haven't talked about in a while. First is I want to talk to you about St. Francis of Assisi, who's actually the patron saint of Colorado. Now, Francis of Assisi lived around 1,000 years ago, give or take, and he was basically a player, you know, for lack of a better word, Mr. Popularity. Son of a fairly wealthy cloth merchant, and would just be a party, just go out and party and live a sinful lifestyle, not a devout Catholic. Eventually, he signed up for the military and went into battle and got captured. And it was around that time where he had a conversion. And one of the big moments of his conversion is he was walking past this Church of San Damiano that was in ruins, and he stopped to pray in front of a crucifix. And because again, he was experiencing his conversion, and Jesus from the crucifix actually spoke to him, and said, "Rebuild my church, which is in ruins. Rebuild my church." Now Francis took Jesus literally and started to physically rebuild that church, the Church of San Damiano. But of course, eventually he realized it was a call to go out and evangelize, a call to rebuild the Church of Christ. Which was struggling from sin. And so he changed his life. He started what we'd call today the the Franciscans, or at that time the Order of Friars Minor. And many people started following him. He got permission from the Pope to start this order. It said he would preach to anyone that would listen, even the birds. You know, he'd preach to anyone. He even went to try to convert the Muslims to try to end the Crusades, the Holy War. The end of his life, or years before he died, he experienced the stigmata, where Jesus appeared to him as like a seraphim, as a seraphic angel, and beams shot out into Francis's hands, feet, and side, and he had the stigmata. Eventually, he passed away, a great saint in the church. Also, Saint Clare of Assisi. Who also grew up in the same town at the time of Francis. Assisi was, Claire was a noblewoman and was, you know, had people proposing to her, you know, courting her and everything. But when she was, I think 17 or 18, she encountered Francis and was so moved by his example of poverty, of such serious poverty and prayer and penance and serving the poor, that she herself gave up everything, gave up her whole life to become a nun and started what we call today the Poor Clares, the girls' side of the Franciscan order. And I've been to Assisi. It's this beautiful town, and it, up on the hill, it looks like the same, like they haven't done much in 1,000 years. They try to preserve to make it look like the way it looked at Francis's time. And, you know, the convent where Claire lived, you just walk through it and you're like, this is tiny. How did, like, so many nuns, you know, live in this convent without, like, tearing each other apart? Well, through the Holy Spirit. Because it's a small place, right? So, St. Claire. Now, there's a picture of her with the Eucharist, because there's a one of the things that happened is there's a group of people who were invading Assisi, and they were going to storm the convent and, I'm sure, do bad things. And Claire, St. Claire, she took the monstrance, which had Jesus in the Holy Eucharist in it, and placed it in front of the doors. And it said that the marauders fell down and ran away. You know, Jesus protected his brides. All right. Another thing I want to just talk about is kind of a Catholic cool thing is the whole realm of bilocation. So in the history of the Catholic Church, there has been many times many saints who had the ability to be in two places at the same time, who could be in their monastery in Italy and appear hundreds or thousands of miles away. One of them, her name is Venerable Mary of Agreda. She was a nun in Spain who bilocated to the Americas, to what is today the United States, what is today Texas and New Mexico, and actually was recorded to have bilocated and went there about 500 times to preach to the Native Americans, to the Indians there, to the Native Americans. And what happened was, the priests and the missionaries hadn't been to this area of the country yet. People hadn't heard about Jesus Christ. And yet, she visited them, she taught them. There were times that some of these groups rejected her, and she had to experience suffering even while bilocating. But she would go back and, like, teach them again. And they talked about this lady in blue that would appear. And eventually, she told this group, whose name is escaping me right now, this group of Native Americans, I want you to go in this direction, and over there you're going to find these priests who will be able to baptize you. And they did. They traveled 300 miles, I think it was 300 miles north. They found the Franciscans who were evangelizing there, and they said, we want to be baptized. And they're like, how do you even know about any of this? And you're like, a lady in blue told us about Jesus. Baptize us. And you're like, and then they did all this investigation, and they're like, yeah, this little nun living in a convent in Spain bilocated to this area and could tell things, could give very detailed descriptions that only a person who actually been there could have told them. But, of course, no one had been there yet because missionaries hadn't even gotten there yet, you know. And so that's one. Another one is St. John Bosco. He was actually reported to, while he was in Italy, appear in South America and run meetings and sign documents. And they have signed documents and signed testimony of, like, yeah, Father John Bosco showed up and ran the meeting. We don't know how, but he did. And then we find out he was actually back in Italy all the time. Or another one, St. Padre Pio, I've talked about, St. Padre Pio, the gift of bilocation. There was one time where, this was during the war, where there was people who were going to bomb his town. And what did he do? He appeared on the wing of the plane. And the pilots saw this, and of course you see a monk on the wing of your plane, you tend to think, something is wrong with my head, I should probably turn around. And they did. They turned around and went back home. Didn't bomb the town. You know? And so you think, how can this happen? Well, of course it's a miracle. It's the realm of miracles. And of course the church investigates it. We don't want to just believe any claim. And to try to verify, like, how do we prove that this actually happened? And these are miracles that have been verified and proven. Like, yeah, these things actually happen. We have eyewitness testimony of these things. Another one was St. Anthony of Padua. One day he was preaching in a church in another town, and he realized while he was preaching that he actually had a commitment to actually, like, go chant the Psalms in another church in another town. And so what did he do? He like stops and he just puts his head down. And they reported that he actually appeared in the church right at that time, chanted the Psalms, did whatever he was supposed to do. And then, you know, all the meanwhile, just standing there. And then all of a sudden he just went and continued on preaching. You know? God can do these things to show us, hey, the miraculous happens, right? Jesus, and I think it, by location specifically, kind of points to the realm of the resurrection, right? That our that God is going to glorify our bodies on the last day, that our resurrected bodies, which are going to be our bodies, will be resurrected, are going to be able to do things that we can't do right now, right? You know, Jesus, after he rose from the dead, walked through walls. Right? Still had a body of flesh and bone, but it was a resurrected, glorified body. He could still say, touch me and see that I'm not a ghost. A ghost does not have flesh and bone as you see I have, but yet still walk through walls. You know, and so that's the power of the resurrection. Okay. Now, I didn't show you. Well, there's a little statue of Venerable Mary of Agreda who had a blue habit. So, all right, I want to go back up here to the graces of Blessed Mary, Venerable Mary of Agreda. Pen. Like a quill. Okay. Let's go back up to the effects of baptism here. Okay. So I just want to take some time to pray now. And to particularly pray over this realm of baptism. Okay? So let's pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for all that you've done for us in Jesus Christ. Lord, we can never earn the graces that you've given us. Because you're so good, you're so holy. But we can thank you. Thank you for creating us in your image. Lord God, help us to believe that we're made in your image. Help us to believe that that you have made us, and that you don't make junk. This world tries to beat us down. This world tries to get us to believe lies, to think that we're no good, think that we're worthless. And Lord Jesus, we just want to renounce those lies in your name. Lord Jesus, we want you to please break those lies in us. Help us to believe that we are made in your image, that there's a goodness there, that you have made us for yourself. You've made us for communion with God. That we're not made for nothingness. We're not made for garbage or junk. You've made us to share in your own life. Help us to believe that. And that, Lord, help us to believe that you want to share your own sonship with us. But Jesus, that you wish to save us, that you wish to bring us into this adoption so we can be children of God, so that we can be filled with your Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, so we can be temples. And so now I'm just going to ask you yourselves, while we're praying, to make an act of faith. Do you believe this? Do you believe that you are made in God's image? You'll have to tell the Lord, yes, Lord, I do believe I'm made in your image. Do you believe that God wants to adopt you, wants to save you, wants to make you his son or daughter? Yes, Lord, I do believe that you wish to adopt me. Lord, yes, Lord, I do believe. If you've been baptized, yes, Lord, I do believe that I have become your son or daughter. Do you believe that God wants to fill you with his Spirit, wants to fill you with his life, fill you with his love? Yes, Lord, I do believe that you wish to fill me with your life, with your love, your goodness. Do you want that? Do you want to experience the outpouring of God's love, outpouring of God's life? So to ask, Lord Jesus, fill my heart with your love. Lord Jesus, I ask, please fill my heart with your love. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, Holy Spirit, help me to pray. Come, Holy Spirit, help me to encounter your life and your love and your goodness. Lord Jesus, I love you. Lord Jesus, I trust you. Lord Jesus, please fill my heart with every grace that I need. Lord Jesus, please remove these lies that I believed about myself. Lord Jesus, heal these wounds. Lord Jesus, fill my heart with your life and your love. I ask all this in your name. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face to you and be gracious to you. May the Lord shine his countenance upon you and fill you with peace. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a good night, everyone. Take care.